Thank you for coming back. And for those of you who have just joined us, welcome. My name's Julie Gilson, and I'm based here in Pulsis. And I'm going to take this short opportunity to say a big thank you to Tsering for organizing this whole event. He asked me for my advice, but actually, I realize now he knows a lot more about organizing these kinds of things than I do. And thanks for all the organization, and thanks for inviting me along to participate. Yeah. I'm very much a free rider here today, just able to...
Put me on a very steady financial footing.
Oh, yeah, I got a bit of money, okay. I do have my uses, that's good to know. Right, the second panel. Unfortunately, Professor Harsh Pant was due to join us today, but has had an emergency at home this morning. So, sadly, he's not able to be here with us. However, our two colleagues here are somewhat pleased about this because it gives them a bit more time to deliver their own presentations. So our focus now is to look more at the consequences of Sino-Indian relations on Southeast Asian politics, and I'm very much looking forward to finding out more about it. We'll start with Professor Srikanth Kondapalli from JNU University in Delhi, and you're going to talk about India-China competition in Southeast Asia. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Julie. Good afternoon to you all. Let me thank Tsering for inviting me for this interaction. Well, the topic is related to Southeast Asia and the interaction between China and India in this region. First, the region itself is well known for its economic integration. After the European Union, this is the major region in the world today which has been intensely integrated in economic issues. Trade liberalization is also one of the major aspects of this region. 10 countries form the ASEAN, Association for Southeast Asian Nations. East Timor yet is a member of the organization, which was formed recently after Indonesia broke up. As you all know, Southeast Asia has over 600 million people, and last year they accounted for nearly 4.4 million square kilometers of territory and about $2 trillion of GDP. Inclusive of all those 10 members. Now, most important, the region forms a part of the sea lanes of communications. For example, several of these countries outside are dependent on the sea lanes of communications, including United States, whose $1 trillion passes through the South China Sea in trade in goods and services. Likewise, Japan is heavily dependent on Southeast Asia for transit of its goods. Mainly energy flows from the Middle East and Africa. We have also South Korea, we have also China, who have substantial interests in the Southeast Asian region. Now, the India-China interaction today has become it has not been very pronounced in terms of an interaction. At the foreign ministry level, there is recently formed structured dialogue process in the East Asian Summit. As you know, the East Asian Summit was formed in 2005, December, and subsequently several meetings were held in Kuala Lumpur, Cebu, Bali, and the next meeting is to be held in Naypyidaw in Myanmar in mid of November this year. The East Asian Summit dialogue process, and recently the Chinese government had expanded the interaction with the ASEAN to include one dialogue partner arrangement within the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Likewise, the Indian Ministry of External Affairs had instituted a permanent representative to the ASEAN. meaning thereby that they have elevated the level of interaction between the two sides, the Indian-ASEAN side. China interacts with the ASEAN at five levels, at the foreign ministry, defense ministry, and a host of other interactions, including economic, technological, and they have a China-ASEAN dialogue process, which includes, apart from the bilateral contacts with individual nations, it also includes the multilateral interactions at the ASEAN ARF, ASEAN Regional Forum, as well as the East Asian Summit meetings. So intensified interactions between China and ASEAN is taking place currently. And this is leading to a lot of mutually beneficial relationship between China and ASEAN, which includes, as compared to about $80 billion bilateral trade between China and ASEAN in 2003, currently the trade is over $450 billion. China-ASEAN trade last year was about $450 billion. They plan to raise this to about $1 trillion by 2020. So which means the economic aspects have been emphasized in the China-ASEAN interactions. Major trading partners, of course, are between Singapore and China, Thailand, China, Indonesia, Malaysia, which are the old ASEAN members. The new ASEAN members are bordering China, Myanmar, Laos, Vietnam. Their trade is relatively less, and today the multilateral kind of initiatives for China are coming from these border provinces of Yunnan, Guangxi, and Guangdong. Guangdong doesn't border ASEAN countries, yet it is putting a lot of pressure on improving relations with the ASEAN members. So what we have is Chinese initiatives related to the Mekong Commission. Secondly, in terms of the BCIM, Bangladesh, China, India, Myanmar initiative, which came up in 1999 as part of Kunming initiative then. Today, these two multilateral initiatives are at the forefront of the Chinese policy in the ASEAN. At the economic level, apart from trade, which is substantially enhanced due to the FTA, free trade area that Premier Churungchi signed in 2001, and which is bubbling now with, as I said, $450 billion trade last year, this suggests that the economic integration levels are moving in an upward direction between China and the ASEAN countries. However, the big problem between China and the ASEAN is the territorial issue. China today, from March 2009, had suggested South China Sea is a core interest for China. Dai Pingkuo, the former state councillor, had suggested this in July 2009. Prior to that, in March 2009, they mentioned about it before. The core interest concept has been actually expanding. China has been pretty flexible about this. During the Cold War, post-Cold War, China mentioned Taiwan and Tibet as core interests. From 2009, China expanded this to include South China Sea. And in 2010, after the Tiahutai Senkaku Islands dispute, they have also expanded this to include the East China Sea islands. So, in other words, the core interest expansion had led to concerns in the ASEAN, especially with Vietnam and Philippines. Although Malaysia is also a partner in this dispute, Malaysia is relatively quiet on that front, except in the maritime domain. The key problem for the international community in terms of the sovereignty disputes is China, Vietnam, and Malaysia are likely to expand this into a territorial aspects, which mean every ship that passes through the South China Sea, which China, Vietnam, and other countries claim, will have to take the permission of these countries. In other words, sovereignty will be imposed on those, including the sea lanes of communications. This is a key problem for the international community, international trade, and so on, if they are passing through these disputed territories. As you all know, China had suggested to the 9 dashed line in South China Sea as part of its claims. And they said during the Ming Dynasty, they have found some tablets, some coins, which suggest to the Chinese sovereignty claims to this region. But this is a specious argument because historical claims under international law are not credible. For example, Britain can claim that during the 19th century it had occupied so-and-so colonies and so still these will be the colonies or possessions of the Brits. It can also be extended to say during Chola dynasty in the medieval period, Indian dynasties have conquered the Southeast Asian region. So it can also be claimed that India still rules over Southeast Asia, if you go by this historical argument. In any case, international legal observation is, if you are in continuous and physical occupation, and if you have proof of those, then there is a possibility for claiming these territories. So this is a key problem for China in terms of legitimizing its claims in the South China Sea. This has really resulted in a lot of rupture between the Southeast Asian countries and China. And during the Hanoi meeting in 2010, as well as subsequently, the East Asian Summit and the ADMM, ASEAN Defense Ministerial Meeting, the meetings were almost disrupted because of these claims, and this has led to huge outcry in the region. Now, during the Nonfeng meeting, the ASEAN did not come out with a declaration, which is quite unusual in its history. For the first time, they did not mention anything, and part of the reason several observers have suggested is to the Chinese pressure on the Southeast Asian countries not to bring the bilateral disputes into the multilateral forum. With the result, we have seen that today the ASEAN is divided over the 9 dashed line, which, as you know, that this has become a crucial issue for the international community as well. The Shangri-La dialogues, which are held with the IISS in London, in Singapore, these meetings have also become very acrimonious. The South China Sea then becomes a problem for the international community. As I mentioned before, the key issue for everyone concerned is the freedom of navigation. If the claimants to the territorial seas restrict international trade, then this becomes a key problem for maritime trade for everyone concerned, which includes, as the former US Secretary of State Hillary Clinton had suggested, US now sees the South China Sea as its national interest because over $1 trillion of its trade is passing through this region. Out of nearly $15 trillion that US has, this is $1 trillion on the South China Sea. So this has become a key problem for the United States. Likewise for Japan, which now, a couple of weeks ago, the Prime Minister of Japan, Shinzo Abe, had indicated to collective defense, which includes regions in South China Sea as well. And today, Japan is exporting arms to Philippines and intending to build up relations with the other ASEAN countries. For India, South China Sea suggests to nearly 55% of its trade. Exports, imports passing through the South China Sea amounts to over 55% of the Indian trade. So while India had not suggested that this has become its national interest, yet it is indeed had become a national interest, which means that, as the old British adage used to say, the flag follows the trade, which means today the Indian Navy is also pretty active in this region with multilateral as well as bilateral exercises, naval exercises conducted with various countries. with ASEAN countries at the multilateral level, as well as bilaterally with Singapore, with Vietnam, with Japan far away in Okinawa. These exercises are being conducted by India to secure those sea lanes of communications. Indeed, the former Indian Naval Chief Admiral Joshi had mentioned that South China Sea is an area of importance for Indian Navy and that they are willing to conduct operations for securing this trade in the region. So Indian interests also got enmeshed in the South China Sea, partly because of this globalization and increasing trade and investments. For example, India had invested over $2 billion in Sakhalin oil wells in Far East Russia and had invested over $5 billion in the Vietnam-held 127, 128 blocks in the South China Sea. These are roughly coinciding with those nine dashed lines. And hence, China also started putting a lot of coercive diplomacy on Indian investments in this region. With this, we see the competitive element coming up between India and China. Now, when the foreign ministry spokesman in Beijing suggested that all oil companies should withdraw from South China Sea, British Petroleum withdrew from this region for some quid pro quo in mainland China for some oil contracts in the domestic market. However, the ONGC, Oil and Natural Gas Commission, insisted on staying back in Vietnam-held areas after Vietnam passed a law suggesting to those islands where the ONGC is drilling are part of the Vietnamese sovereignty. So, in other words, sovereignty issues have also become an area of contention between India and China, and this has led to a competitive element. Briefly, the Indian interactions with Southeast Asia include, as part of the Lucky's policy, India had initiated mutually beneficial, like that of the Chinese, mutually beneficial trade contacts with all the 10 ASEAN countries. India borders the Southeast Asian region with Myanmar in the continental domain and in the maritime domain with Indonesia and Thailand in terms of the Bay of Bengal and the Straits of Malacca connecting in a maritime neighborhood. Now, India had proposed to the ASEAN at the Shangri-La dialogue that Indian Navy could provide for support in terms of counter-piracy operations. As you know, South America is the first dominant place where the number of piracy incidents are rampant across the globe. The figures are something like 50 to 60 a month in the Caribbean and other places. The second main area of piracy across the globe is South China Sea. And this used to be for the last decade or so, or more than a decade, the maximum number of piracy incidents used to happen from that region. Malaysia, Singapore, and Indonesia started a multilateral counter-piracy operation and countered this effectively in the last 6 or 7 years. India also suggested that there could be an Indian Navy assistance in countering the piracy-related issues in South China Sea. So Indian role is to put across its military capabilities for countering these non-traditional security issues. This has been a major aspect when we look at the 2004-05 tsunami, which had resulted in over 30,000 victims in this natural disaster. Now, Indian Navy mobilized some 26,000 sailors to evacuate the victims from Thailand, Indonesia, Sri Lanka, Maldives, and Myanmar during that point of time by mobilizing its naval forces across the Southeast Asian, South Asian region, and the Indian Ocean regions. Now, this has become a major factor in the India-Southeast Asia interactions. And this is one of the areas that India is looking for more cooperation between India and Southeast Asia. Apart from trade, which is, as I mentioned, 55% of the trade is passing through, Indian trade is passing through the Southeast Asian waters. India also has the FTA now signed with the ASEAN countries. From about 2010, for the last 4 years, India had been active in pursuing the FTA proposals, much like the Chinese have done, although the Chinese FTA is more intensive than compared with India-ASEAN FTA, because by being a democratic country, India has a lot of pressures to contend with, including various constituents, chambers of commerce, and so on. And hence, the India-ASEAN FTA had been relatively slowed down because of these concerns on the crucial lists, trade lists, as part of the exchange between ASEAN and India. Nevertheless, today, ASEAN-India trade is expected to be about $100 billion by the next year, 2015, which is about $85 billion last year, which is expected to grow to about $100 billion, which is, in comparison to the Chinese, about one-fourth of the China-ASEAN trade. Security-wise, there are several proposals, and since India now today is entering into the energy oil blocks in the South China Sea, this has become a contentious point between China and India. That's where the competitive trend had come up. If not conflict, there is a lot of competition. As I mentioned before, there has been over $5 billion of investment so far by the energy firms, not just the state-owned, but also private energy companies have invested from India in the Southeast Asian region. And this has become kind of broad-based in terms of their quest for energy. Overall, then, the contest is happening. But if you look at the Southeast Asia region as a whole, this used to be the backyard of the multilateral grouping ASEAN, established in the late 1960s. And this has been in the forefront, which is now parroted out by every other party as part of the driver's seat in the ASEAN Regional Forum or in the East Asian Summit meetings. So essentially, this region has become contentious between various countries, including between India and China in the recent period. I would suggest that the Chinese perceptions have been changing over a period of time, and I looked at mainly the thesis and PhD thesis and MA dissertation submitted in various universities to argue that China today has a comprehensive policy also to counter the Indian role, number one, by intensifying strategic partnerships with the ASEAN countries. Number two, in terms of naval modernization, Chinese Navy modernization and identifying Sanya as the forward post for China's naval expansion in the South China Sea, as well as part of the two ocean strategy to come into the Indian Ocean region, apart from the Pacific Ocean, that had become a policy option for the Chinese. Number three is China is mainly trying to counter any US-India-Japan kind of arrangement in the South China Sea. As you know, the former Defense Secretary of the US, Panetta, had mentioned to the possible linchpin role that India can play in the South China Sea. Hillary Clinton also had mentioned to such, and she suggested to Indo-Pacific rather than Asia-Pacific or Indian Ocean, Pacific Ocean. So you have a new construct in which the alliances of democracies, the idea which is not new, which is coming up again, is one of that US, Japan, India kind of trilateral. So China's effort is to kind of break or to see that this alliance doesn't take off in the future. So I found in the writings, Chinese writings, especially in the academic, and I find that the MA dissertations and PhD thesis in China are much more vocal, much more open than compared with anything which is published. So from an academic point of view, I would suggest you to consult more MA dissertations and PhD thesis in China. Of course, some Chinese supervisors tell me, academic supervisors tell me, this is, most of this is plagiarized, or most of this is not really up to the mark, and so on and so forth. But I really find it worthwhile to read them, to see a different view than compared with what appears in the public. Because in Chinese, the thumb rule is anything which is published will have to go through the censorship, while an MA dissertation or a PhD thesis technically is not a published one, and hence you find in these very frank kind of submission so I find this very forthcoming, and I would suggest you to look at. For example, Rum Xiantong, I will read his MA dissertation submitted to the Foreign Affairs College, Foreign Affairs Institute in Beijing in June 2004. He argued that Luki's policy will squeeze political and diplomatic space of China, which is a very, very strong statement that he made, but it reflects to a certain intention. It reflects to a certain base the discussions that are available in the Foreign Affairs Institute. By the way, last week I made a lecture in the Foreign Affairs Institute in Beijing. They have about 2,000 students, and most of their theses and dissertations are put up on CNKI and Wanfang data. So you can access these if you have subscribed to this database. So he suggests to the Luki's policy of India having military strategic dimensions as well, that China need to factor in, China need to counter that policy. I have also taken 5 case studies briefly on how these competitive trends are reflected. Number one is in terms of China's relations and India's relations with Myanmar. From 1988, the military junta is in place. From 2007-8 onwards, the country has been opened up for liberalization and elections, most important. This has become a bubbling place today in terms of political debate as well as investments and so on and so forth. Myanmar today has become a test case between China and India. Previously, from 1988, following the cohesion between the military junta and the Chinese leadership's position, because both were isolated in a way after the Tiananmen Square incident in 1989 in China, as well as the sanctions imposed on Myanmar following the 1988 takeover by the SLOC in Rangoon, the relations between China and Myanmar substantially were enhanced, and these included not just the construction of dams across the Irrawaddy and Salween Mekong in Southeast Asia, but specifically on Irrawaddy River in Myanmar, but also in terms of mining projects, in terms of infrastructure projects, road, railways, airfield, and coastal cities construction. It included also military assistance to the military junta. Over $2 to $3 billion of assistance was given to the military junta in Rangoon during that point of time. So a cohesion between the two came up from 1988 onwards. However, by 90s and 2000s, we have seen Myanmar now testing, as they realized that they are coming heavily under the Chinese influence. Remember that Myanmar was one of the founding members of the non-aligned movement. Being fiercely independent, they also now thought that there is scope for becoming independent from China as well, because of their heavy dependence on China. So here, from late 90s, especially from 2000s, they started moving away from China, and you have now, after United Nations diplomat Gambari's visit to Myanmar, last 6 or 7 years, the whole region was opened up, and international sanctions, et cetera, have been removed. You today find a contest here. In the case of India,
just 2 minutes, please.
In the case of India, it followed initially support to the democracy for Aung San Suu Kyi, and then with national interests in its as a main aspect, it was equidistant from the military junta as well as the Aung San Suu Kyi's National League of Democracy and other. Now today, India had been in the forefront again, coming up with this normalization with Burma. This is in the light of the Kokang uprising, where some 55,000 Chinese were driven away to Yunnan when these incidents took place. India-China contest, the second area that I have chosen, is the multilateral institutions. While both are talking, there is a lot of competitive kind of interaction in the East Asian Summit, in other institutions as well. I have already mentioned about the energy-related issues in which the competitive element has come to the fore, especially in South China Sea. There is also the naval forces modernization, which India and China are actively conducting. Surprisingly, this year, early this year, President Xi Jinping, through State Councillor Yang Jiechun, had suggested to a maritime Silk Road new concept, which has been proposed to India. While we do not know the ABCDs of the maritime Silk Road, it is clear that there is China is intending to construct a continental maritime Silk Road and a maritime Silk Road to counter the US rebalancing. So China is approaching India in this front, while India is non-committal as of now. And that's partly because while tensions are mounting between India and China in South China Sea, in China wants to come into the Indian Ocean region, where India has huge geopolitical advantages. So in conclusion, I would suggest that the competitive trend between the two, China and India, the two, the increasing official word is simultaneously rising. For the last 6-7 years, the Chinese are using this word simultaneous rise, although there is a huge difference between the Chinese rise and the Indian rise. I would suggest that the competitive trend is coming to the fore in the recent period, as both India and China are emphasizing on their national interests. Their security concerns are mounting, especially in terms of trade and energy flows. However, this such competitive trend has not really been exacerbated because their outreach, Chinese outreach and Indian outreach into the Southeast Asian region or South China Sea, is not very, very I mean, they have limitations in this outreach. Since the US still is a major factor in South China Sea and Southeast Asia, so there are limitations in the China-India competitive trend. The other finding that I have for you is, and this is my last point, China insists on its core interests, Taiwan, Tibet, and now South China Sea, and now Tiaoyutai, from 2009-10 onwards. However, when it comes to India's core interests, we have seen that China is investing in the Pakistan-controlled Kashmir, which is, as stated by the Chinese government in the 50s and 60s and so on, that this is a disputed territory. So we see that in contrast, on the Indian core interests, there has not been much forthcoming from China on that issue. So this is one reason why there has been much heartburn, and also the Indian inroads into the South China Sea. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you. It's great to get the perspective on the South China Sea from the other side, as someone who looks at Japan's problems in the region, and you realize just how complex the relationships are. Right. We've been talking a lot about Tibet in the earlier session as well, and I think Tsering's going to focus on the Indian and Nepalese handling of the Tibetan issue specifically now.
First of all, I would like to clarify so that you don't go away with the wrong impression. Julie was the best colleague and mentor that I could, you know, hope for. So
I'll pay you later.
Yeah. And it's an honor to share the table with Professor Kondapalli as well. So my topic is not as meaty as the other papers, I think, because I mostly deal with a dispossessed people and a small puny Himalayan kingdom. But it's South Asian responses to China's rise, Indian and Nepalese handling of the Tibet issue. Basically, when I look at the literature on the broader literature on responding to the rise of China, I see that it is US-centric. So we have the literature on power transition between the United States and China, or the broader Western world and China. And the literature focusing on the rise of China, you know, responding to the rise of China from Asian countries is mostly East Asia-centric. Japan and other ASEAN and other Northeast Asian countries are responding to China. South Asia is not missing, as I wrongly put it here, but it's dominated by the relationship between India and China, the traditional rivalry, and so it is mostly dealt with in through the narrative of the string of pearls, the so-called string of pearls. Competition between China and India and the other Southeast Asian states being just pearls in their power play. And then like to briefly look at some of the theories on how weak and middle power states respond to rising states. So we're not talking about how the hegemon, existing hegemon responds to the rising power, but how other states. So we have, I won't go through detail because I wouldn't have time, and I want to end in time because I've been quite persistent on the first panel. The first set of strategies comes from mainly the realist perspective, which is balancing. And then secondly, bandwagoning. And then there's this strategy of hedging, and then subordination. So basically responding to the power, the material capabilities of the rising power. And then a third set of strategies coming mainly from the liberal or neoliberal theories is by inducing economic interdependence with the rising power. And then the second is institutional enmeshment by inviting the rising power into institutions, a network of institutions, and constraining its behavior and ambitions. And then a third debatable or problematic is democracy promotion, if you are a democratic country. So if you are from Taiwan, for example, you know, there have been people talking about, you know, Taiwan being an example for People's Republic of China. And then there's a third set of strategies that comes from the constructivist or critical theories, looking at how ideas, identity, norms, and culture could be deployed to constrain or influence the rising power. The first strategy is socialization of the rising power into appropriate behavior, and then also trying to cultivate collective identities, as it was pointed out, I think, by one of the speakers this morning, Professor Callahan. And then there is also transformation, trying to transform the identity and interests of the rising power through deep engagement and through one's own appropriate behavior and language. And then institutional enmeshment, which is slightly different from the liberal idea of using institutions. basically regulation of behavior or normative standards, and in the process also transforming the identity and interests of the rising power. And then there's another idea which is looks at whether one has a common culture or civilization with the rising power. So this is what where David Kang comes in when he talks about the future of East Asia in relation to China. But there are others who try to combine various theories, borrow from various theories, and then trying to come up with different strategies. So Robert Pape in 2005 came up with what is called soft balancing, which means using institutions, economic statecraft, and diplomatic arrangements to delay, frustrate, and undermine aggressive unilateral policies. This is especially in relevance to how other countries respond to US unilateral policies, but this can easily be replicated in the case of China. And then especially focusing on East Asia, especially Southeast Asia, Callahan came up with what is called institutional balancing, countering pressures or threats through initiating, utilizing, and dominating multilateral institutions to pursue security under anarchy. This also involves using economic instruments. So looking at the existing literature on how Asian states respond to China, which is East Asia focused from my perspective, we can also, well, this is the way I categorize them, but I'm sure there'll be many who would disagree with the way I did it. But most countries use hedging, what is called hedging. So hedging is a very broad band within which you could see different types of hedging, some closer to balancing, some closer to bandwagoning. So we could see Japan and Philippines, as Professor Kondapalli pointed out, could be seen as hedgers, but on the closer to the balancing side. And then there are countries who are hedging and only moderately balancing against China. We could see Australia, Singapore, and Vietnam. And then we could hedging, but also trying to deploy common cultural and historical experience in the case of South Korea. As you know, Chinese president visited South Korea very recently, and he tried to use the common Japanese imperialism as a way to bring the two countries closer. But then there are what I would call pure hedgers, countries like Indonesia, Thailand, Malaysia, and Burma, who sit in the middle and try to get security and economic benefits from different great powers. And then institutional balancers, we could see that most Southeast Asian nations are using this sort of hybrid strategy. And then we could also say that potentially most East Asian nations would use soft balancing in the future. North Korea is a non-troublesome ally of China, and there are Cambodia and Laos who could be seen as bandwagoning with China, as we saw from how they tried, Cambodia especially used the ASEAN presidency to on the South China Sea dispute. Now, going to the South Asia, South Asian responses to China's rise. As I pointed out, it is dominated by the Sino-Indian rivalry and the narrative of a string of pearls, which was originally actually conceived by Pentagon officials to talk about Chinese actions in the Indian Ocean. The South Asian nations also have to have their own sub-regional dynamic, which is to respond to India's rise. So their response to China's rise is complicated by their need to adjust to India's rise. And except for India, none has the military and economic wherewithal to dabble in balancing or sub-balancing with China. South Asia also lacks the institutional capital, unlike Southeast Asia, to use institutional balancing. Among the South Asian nations, Pakistan has been and always been an informal ally. Pakistan is called it the all-weather friends. India could be seen as a hedging balancer. And then there are Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, and Maldives, who could be seen as pure hedgers, sitting in, on the fence and trying to play each other off and get maximum benefits. And then Nepal, I would say, is a selective bandwagoner or bandwagoning hedger, a country that bandwagons on some issues and then hedges and use other strategies on other issues. And then Bhutan is a small Himalayan kingdom, is more or less of an Indian protectorate. So to move to the issue, the Tibetan issue, why I'm using the Tibetan case. Tibet has been declared by the Chinese as a core issue. The core issues concept has been used since 2003 to initially talk about Taiwan. But then since 2006, the Chinese started to use the core issue concept to frame the Tibet issue. And they started off in Sri Lanka, which is a Buddhist kingdom. And secondly, India and Nepal host the largest Tibetan diaspora in South Asia. India, approximately 120,000, and Nepal, 20,000. And as was pointed out earlier, the activities of the Tibetan diaspora is very, very disturbing and a major issue for the Chinese. And before 1989, India and Nepal had roughly similar policies towards the Tibetans. It's quite easy as well as useful to see the differences. And they also represent two different Chinese approaches. The Chinese use one approach towards the Indians and another approach towards the Nepalese in terms of the intensity of the pressure on the Tibet issue. And they also represent two different South Asian responses to China's rise. Another issue, usefulness is that Nepal's present could be the future of middle power states who would confront a more powerful and less constrained China. So to start with the Indian handling of the Tibet issue, first of all, I should identify a number of key issues that are Tibet-related in Sino-Indian relations. First is the legal status of Tibet. Now this is more or less resolved because since 1954, when India and China signed an agreement on Tibet, when India accepted Chinese sovereignty over Tibet, and India has formally always repeated that position. The other issue is the activities of the Tibetan exiles, diaspora in India. You know that the Dalai Lama is living in India. There is the Central Tibetan Administration, which is a de facto government in exile, which looks after the Tibetan diaspora as well as campaigns for Tibetan autonomy in the rest of the world. And then as you can see from some of the pictures, the one picture with the Dalai Lama, the gentleman is the Sikyo, or the Prime Minister of the Tibetan government in exile. And then you could see that there are schools. There are over 80 Tibetan schools in different parts of India, many of which have been funded and staffed by Indian government. And then you could see the monasteries. Most of the major monasteries, Tibetan monasteries, which were destroyed during the Cultural Revolution, have been replicated in different parts of India. This is just one example. And then you could see the picture here. There is what is called a 22 division. There is a division of Tibetan soldiers in the Indian army under the direct command of the Prime Minister, who have participated in many of the major operations again during the Bangladesh independence movement, during the Kargil wars with Pakistan, during the Sikh uprising in Golden Temple and all of that. So the India, and then you could see from this picture that the Tibetan Prime Minister in exile has been accorded very high security levels, you know, when he was going around in India. So the activities of the Tibetans is a major issue. But for the Indians, the military development on the Tibetan plateau is very, very significant. So it contributes to the security dilemma between India and China. So India needs to spend a lot of resources as well as soldiers maintaining the security in the northeastern regions. And then there are many other issues like Chinese management of the rivers and glaciers in Tibet, because they serve as lifelines for many Indian people. So there are many other issues, both traditional and non-traditional security issues between the two countries. But India's attitude and policy towards the Tibetans has been quite reflected in recent weeks. When Narendra Modi, the new prime minister, was inaugurated, for the first time, the Tibetan prime minister in exile was invited and sat among the front rows in full public view. Even the Dalai Lama was not accorded that sort of importance. And then, so for the Tibetans, it was very satisfying and represented some sort of new development. But a few weeks after that, the Chinese foreign minister Wang Yi came to New Delhi, and then the Tibetans who live in Delhi, who wanted to protest, were barricaded by the police. So it represents a cautious type of hedging that India has been using with the Tibetan case. On the one hand, accepting Chinese sovereignty, but supporting Tibetans in many other ways, including facilitating diplomatic campaigns around the world. So while China's pressure on India has been restrained on the Tibet issue, India has also been using a more cautious hedging strategy on the Tibet issue. But when it comes to Nepal, it's a slightly different story. So I would consider Nepal's strategy as a case of selective bandwagoning. Nepal finds the Tibet issue as a relatively cost-free issue to bandwagon with China. So before 1989, Tibetans viewed Nepal as a safe haven, just like India, an economic opportunity even. Before 1989, 1990s, Nepal was the place to go for Tibetan refugees because there was a thriving Tibetan carpet industry, which made many Tibetans in India, in Nepal, millionaires. before 1974, there was a Tibetan guerrilla base in a place called Mustang or Lo Mantang, which was financed by the CIA, supported by the Indian government, and also tolerated by the Nepalese government. So it was a guerrilla base as well. And then before 1989, Tibetans were given what is called a refugee card. It did not give them the rights of a citizen for employment and for many rights, but it allowed them to live in Nepal and find ways to survive. But 1989, Nepalese government stopped issuing the refugee identity card for the Tibetans. And Nepal is important because it is the main route through which Tibetans escape Tibet and then come to India to join the bigger Tibetan diaspora. So there are two issues. One is the political activity of the Tibetans who live in Nepal, and also the escape of Tibetans across the border when it comes to Nepal-Chinese relations. And why did these changes come about? First is, improving relations between Nepal and China. And then in 1987, there were broad-based Tibetan protests in Lhasa, the Tibetan capital city, which went on until 1993. And the crackdown resulted in an exodus of Tibetan political activists. So there was a greater number of Tibetans for the Nepalese to handle. And then the decline of the Tibetan carpet industry also made it easier for the Nepalese to tone down the importance of the Tibetans. So since then, the situation for the Tibetans in Nepal has been deteriorating, especially after 2008, when there was another round of major uprising in Tibet, which resulted in increasing Chinese pressure, which is accompanied by China's rise as Nepal's main provider of foreign aid and investment. So how do we explain Nepal's shift? First is domestic political instability in Nepal itself. For about 20 years, Nepal had a series of governments run by coalitions among political parties, which collapsed year after year and year after. So there was instability of government. And then since 1996, there was a Maoist insurgency, which captured many districts of Nepal. And then there was also a movement against the Nepalese king, the royal family, which worsened when in 2001, the Crown Prince Dipendra assassinated his father along with about six or seven of his family members, and then killed himself, which resulted in the enthronement of one of the brothers of the slain king, who decided to take back power from the parliament and run Nepal as an autocratic monarch, which resulted in cooperation among the Maoists and the democratic forces and his overthrow. So all this instability meant that whoever was in power needed Chinese diplomatic support. If he was an authoritarian ruler, needed Chinese economic support, whoever it was. And also if it was a Maoist, you could see that there's a natural sort of alliance with Nepal. So it contributed to the deteriorating situation for the Tibetans. And then there was also a South Asian dynamic, as I pointed out earlier. The Nepalese resent the Indians, see India as a hegemonic power, throwing its weight around and bullying Nepal and smaller countries. So they needed a counterbalance to India. And China was an easy candidate. And then China, by 2000, China was starting to supplant traditional sources of foreign aid and FDI for Nepal, like Japan, India, Norway, and many other European countries, as well as multilateral donors. And then as China became more important as an economic source asset, it also upped the pressure on Nepal, on the Tibet issue. So some sort of examples of Chinese pressure and influence. Pushpa Kamal Dahal, who was the Prime Minister of Nepal when the Maoists were in power, revealed in 2013, when after he met with Chinese President Xi Jinping, that China's major concern in his relations with Nepal was security in Tibet. And then another delegation who went to Beijing came back and revealed that more than anything else, the Chinese seemed to worry about the anti-China activities of Tibetan refugees living in Nepal. And although China still sort of plays upon Nepal's residual fears of Chinese invasion of Nepalese territory, using the Tibetans as a pretext, China's main instrument is economic. So by late 2013, China actually became the top source of foreign direct investment for China, for Nepal, even replacing India, which was its traditional source of foreign direct investment. And China has been giving large amounts of aid in various forms to Nepal. For example, in 2011, Chinese General Chen Dingde, Chief General of Staff of the People's Liberation Army, visited Nepal and offered US dollar 19 million in military aid. Former Security Chief Zhou Yongkang, who is now in trouble, as most of us know, offered US dollar 50 million when he visited Nepal. And in 2012, Prime Minister Wen Jiabao declared US dollar 113 million in aid, plus US dollar 20 million in grant, and a 3-year economic and technical cooperation grant of Chinese yuan 750 million. And then China also directly gives US dollar 42,500 to all the 14 districts that border with Tibet, because the Tibetans escape, and you know they are the first ones to confront the Tibetan escapees. And many of these Chinese foreign aid has a security and infrastructure project focus, for example, building roads and dry ports along the border, targeting the Tibetan problems of escape and political activity. So this map shows where the Tibetans live in Nepal and where they come in and go. So I could not get this over into the slide, so I'll just very quickly read. Nepal's growing dependence on Chinese economic aid has resulted in high levels of security cooperation on the Tibetan issue. A pattern of increasing security cooperation is observable in correlation with the level of economic largesse Nepal receives from China. In response to the Tibetan uprising in 2008, Beijing put forward a comprehensive security agreement, which was adopted and signed during the visit of Zhou Yongkang in 2011. However, more specific security agreements targeting illegal immigration, which the Chinese used to describe Tibetan escapees, intelligence sharing, deployment of Nepalese armed police at the border, and the funding and training of Nepalese security forces, all targeting the movement of Tibetan escapees and controlling the political activities of the Tibetan residents in Nepal. In 2009, Nepal agreed to create border security bases to curb illegal activities in locations which are all key entry points for Tibetan escapees. Each base will be manned by a squad of armed police force. A year later, Nepal and China signed a 13-point intelligence sharing agreement on security issues designed to combat anti-China activities in Nepal. In exchange for Nepalese information and intelligence on Tibetans and security measures to contain political activities, China undertook full support in capacity building and training of Nepal's security forces for deployment along the border with Tibet. True enough, Nepalese security officials from the districts bordering Tibet were given 2 weeks of training in Beijing to bolster Nepal's immigration system. In November 2010, Chinese authorities convened a meeting with senior Nepalese officials from the border district in a border town in Chautala, where it was agreed to tighten the entry of Tibetan nationals into Nepal. This was followed by a visit to Nepal by the director of the Public Security Bureau of the Tibet Autonomous Region, who met the Nepalese Home Minister and top officials from the security forces and intelligence department and pledged financial assistance to the tune of $80,000 to the Nepalese security forces, citing the importance of tackling cross-border drug trafficking and human trafficking. So I conclude here by saying that Nepal and India have similar Tibetan issues with China, but China uses different approaches, different levels of pressure, and these two countries have responded to this particular pressure from China in different ways. So I will end there. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Right, the floor is yours. Open for questions.
Great presentation. Tsering, I have a question for you. I guess it's the same question I had for Professor Bala before. You didn't really talk much about the Indian response to using Tibet as a pawn, Tibet as a pawn. Do you have more to say about that?
Yeah. the line I'm often criticizes the Indian government when he is questioned about Indian policies or on the Tibet issue by saying that the Indian government is overtly cautious. So the only time when the Indians, to my knowledge, tried to use the Tibetans against China was in the 1960s when they, Indians and Chinese fought a war in 1962. That's when they decided to form this Tibetan division in the Indian Army to be used against the Chinese, in Tibet, in the event of another war. But when relations improved in the 1970s, 1980s, the Indians have more or less not given up the card, Tibetan card, but have kept it in a locker, basically, in a safe for some future use. So they have not used the Tibetans to the extent that they could have used, but they have not given up the card as well. So that's the point I was making when I was saying India is using a hedging strategy on the Tibet issue.
One question to Professor Kondapalli. Many thanks for your really interesting presentation. Still, I'm left wondering, and I know you're not here as a government spokesperson. Nonetheless, what is India's response to the, so to say, bilateral approach that China has taken towards Southeast Asia, which in many ways has led some observers to question whether ASEAN is still in the driver's seat. Is India's response to, for example, South China Sea and so on, is it a multilateral one? And does that also then extend to the Myanmar issue? Or how can we make sense of India's response to China's rise and the what you've described as increasing, not conflict, but competition between China and India? Thank you.
Well, the Indian defense minister, former defense minister, when he was the defense minister, Mr. A.K. Anthony, stated that the South China Sea dispute has to be resolved at a bilateral level. So the government of India clarified by saying that this is a bilateral issue between, say, China, Vietnam, China, Philippines, China, whatever, Brunei, China, on the South China Sea. So in the Indian government's opinion, that is a bilateral issue on that. What about Myanmar? I didn't really understand the multilateral or a bilateral issue on the Myanmar case. But whether the ASEAN is still in the driver's seat in the East Asian Summit, ARF, and so on, yes, indeed. That's been the case for with every country, which is part of the multilateral process in ARF in East Asian Summit. That has been agreed to as part of the deal between every country which joins the ARF and the East Asian Summit, that ASEAN is in the driver's seat. So they keep repeating ad nauseum that it's part of the, it is the driver's, it is in the driver's seat.
Hello, can everyone hear me? Adam Quinn from the Political Science Department here. This is a question, I guess, for both of you, and the extent to which you can answer it is uncertain, but I'll put it out there and you can see what you can do anyway. If there is a reason why China is increasing its potential leverage over the countries in the region right now, it's clearly to do with increasing economic capacity, right? That it has a lot more potential to invest in other people's countries. That offers potential for influence and also access to trade with its much larger and more prosperous economy is the basis there. So if that's to turn into strategic influence, then I guess the issue is what Henry Kissinger back in the day called linkage, right? Where you try to make some kind of tie between people's need for you in one area and your ability to then bend them to your will in others. In the case of the United States, it was more that you used your security guarantees to leverage economic concessions. This would be more the other way around, I assume, that you would take your increasing economic necessity to countries in the region and try to turn it into an ability to coddle them for security reasons. What I want to ask is, how explicit do you think that process is in terms of China's relations with countries in this region? There is this huge rise in direct investment. You talked about the importance of it to some of these countries. When they sit down around a table with Chinese officials who also want them to do other things in other policy areas, most notably security, maybe row in behind them on some disputes with third parties and so on,
I think I might kill the microphone. How explicit do they make that linkage between their economic power and their desired security policy outcomes, if you know, if anyone knows?
I can speak on the, you know, Tibetan issue in Nepal. The linkage is quite, you know, explicit. Of course, Nepalese, you know, sitting Nepalese officials would not talk about it openly. But interviews with, you know, former Nepalese officials, both in Kathmandu, the capital, as well as in the local districts, they make it quite clear that, you know, they were facing very strong pressure, not just from their, you know, senior leaders in Kathmandu or the higher ups, but from Chinese, you know, officials. So one Nepalese official explains that there is an asymmetry of access. A low-level Chinese official from the embassy would have access to very senior officials in Nepalese government. And as pointed out, one of their main missions is to, you know, combat the problem of Tibetan political activities and escape. And then there's also photographic as well as witness accounts of Chinese officials physically directing Nepalese policemen whenever there are, you know, Tibetan protests in front of. They don't happen now because of severe restrictions. But in 2008, after that and before that, there used to be frequent Tibetan protests in front of the Chinese embassy, in front of the UNHCR office. There would be Chinese officials directing Nepalese police in controlling Tibetan, you know, protest. And there was also the case of the CNN crew who visited one of the, you know, entry points called Tatabani, when they were filming on the Nepalese side, and Chinese officials from their side came all the way and told them not to film. And then you also have cases of Chinese border guards coming deep into Nepalese territory to intercept Tibetan escapees. So these are some of the sort of clear indications of the strong level of Chinese influence as well as security measures in Nepal itself. And the Nepalese, for the reasons I explained, have also done their bit for the, you know, Chinese government in terms of controlling Tibetan escape, including, you know, deporting Tibetans back into Chinese hands. which means, you know, many number of consequences for them.
I'll try to attempt. China today is the largest trading partner for 128 countries out of 190-odd countries in the international system. 128 countries, the largest trading partner. But this largest trading partnership is uneven. With some countries, with most countries, it has a favorable balance of trade position. For example, with the United States, they have $562 billion trade last year, out of which $490 billion is Chinese exports, and about $70-80 billion is US exports to China. With EU, it is about $600 billion, $582 billion trade last year. And Chinese exports constitute nearly about $400 billion to the EU as a whole, 27 countries. With Japan, roughly about $300 billion. Again, the balance of trade position is in favor of China. Taiwan, over $200 billion, with ASEAN, over $400 billion. These are the largest trading partners. But if you look at the China-Central Asia trade, the balance of payments position is in favor of the Central Asian republics as compared to the all the other trading partners of China. They have an unfavorable balance of trade position with the Central Asian republics. But this is basically because Kazakhstan is exporting gas and oil. For example, 88% of the China-Kazakh trade is of gas. So there is so it means raw material basically is sold to the Chinese. With all other countries, they have surplus trade. China has a surplus trade. Meaning balance of payments position is in favor of China. With South Asia, China has a $110 billion trade, roughly, and out of which China has, with India, China has about $34 billion excess every year. So cumulatively about $167 billion from 2007 till now of the balance of payments position in favor of China. With Pakistan, with Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Nepal, everyone else, China has a favorable balance of trade position. Southeast Asia, the same story. Balance of payments position is in favor of China. So this is beneficial. Whether that has led to China using this as a political tool or a security tool, so far we have seen only a mixed kind of response. Let me give a few examples. With the United States, this has not been a major political tool for China. In fact, the other way around. US had actually seen that as a political tool for economic interdependence and to bring China into the mainstream, as they said. When Obama told Xi Jinping, we welcome the rise of China, he was actually changing the entire spectrum from the Soviet Union, which was seen as a Satan, to China as we welcome the rise of China, meaning we have a beneficial relationship. So it is actually the US which changed the discourse as compared to the Soviet Union with that of the Chinese. With this trade, investments, and so on, so much so that the Chinese are now got interlocked with the US by investing $1.2 trillion. The Chinese cannot get away from this investment in the US Treasury securities, because if they withdraw, then it will have an impact on the renminbi internationalization. If they withdraw, their own stock exchange, Shanghai Stock Exchange, will collapse. If the Wall Street has a problem, then the Shanghai Stock Exchange will also have a problem, which means the 150 million people who invested in the Shanghai stock will also go down the drain, as with the Americans. So they're now interlocked into the whole, and they cannot move out of this gridlock in a way. It's not a in a negative sense, but in a positive sense as well. It's with EU is the same story, except for a few now and then flashes in the pan when Sarkozy meets with the Dalai Lama, when Cameroon has the Tibetan issue up his sleeves, and he goes to Beijing for investments, Chinese investments for Manchester, London, high-speed railway. So there are questions, but so far it has not been a major issue. Flashes in the pan basically on the human rights related and the democracy aspect. But this has not really disturbed anyone, the Chinese or the EU constituents. So in the case of China-EU, again, this has not become very contentious. It was contentious, but the Chinese were able to put in pressure through investments route and so on and so forth. Angela Merkel also met with the Dalai Lama, and after that, the Chinese protests, she never met. So there was also the Chinese pressure on Germany on the Tibetan factor, and the Taiwanese as well, Taiwan factor as well, the One China policy. And the EU has a trade and economic and culture centers in Taiwan, but they don't deal with politics, they don't deal with security. Of course, the trade embargo is still there, which is a part of that security kind of after the Tiananmen Square incident in 1989. In the case of Japan, China, the trade investments, etc., have not led to major security problems. It's a different problem. The nationalism, the territorial issue on Senkaku, Tiaitai, were not part of the trade related, meaning they have over $300 billion trade. Japan is the largest, one of the largest investors in China. They invested $280 billion in Chinese market. $280 billion out of $1 trillion that China received, one-third is from the Japanese. Even during Shinzo Abe's time, early period from 2012, we haven't seen any decline in investments, sharp decline in investments. So the security thing has been bifurcated with that of the trade investments and so on with Japan, where you actually can see Keohane's interdependence theory tested on the rare earth metals ban, where you have the asymmetric interdependence actually tested on that case when the Chinese banned the rare earth metals to the Japanese. So overall, we see kind of mixed figure, mixed picture on the trade, investment, security, politics, and so on. There is a Chinese proverb, Yimin Weicheng, basically through people influencing public policy, through merchants influencing the public policy, which is also quite legitimate international practice, because UK embassies do that, US embassies do that abroad, of influencing the chambers of commerce, investments, and so on. So the Chinese are not doing anything radically different. But this proverb suggests to a kind of concerted effort to enter into. And since, unlike UK, US, or India, which are transparent, where you know everything that happens everywhere, so in the case of China, we do not know that what is happening and who is responsible. We do know that there is a Shanghai gang which is in power now. Xi Jinping belongs to that Shanghai faction, but we do not know what levels of transparency in terms of policy and so on and so forth. So this is a crucial problem of influencing the trading lobbies, chambers of commerce, and the public policy. In democratic societies, it is a usual practice of influencing them. The chambers of commerce do influence the public policy, but we do not know the end product, end game of this trade plus security in the case of China. Through this proverb, we do not know what the intent, what the end game is of that policy. So the picture is not clear.
I think you've just answered, delivered half of my second year course in one answer, which is quite impressive. We've got Professor Bala. Power.
Okay, so this is just a small question from for Professor Kondapalli. You know, on the trade front, where things are looking brighter between India and China, with 100 billion trade almost crossed, the target years are crossed much before than the target year comes in. But on the other hand, there's also a growing fear amongst the public intellectuals in India of the pearl of string theory, countered by India's claim in South China or maybe growing competition in Myanmar. So how do you think this destabilizing the South Asia region as a whole, or do you see this as China's deliberate attempt to create certain pockets all around the Indian subcontinent so as to continue to hold on to its hegemonic presence there?
Thank you. I think the traditionally the Chinese policy reports, academic output, they used to say India is an important country in South Asia, which is also the US position, UK position most of the time. But I think that doesn't do justice in the globalization period, because India is kind of asymmetries are quite huge in terms of resources, people, GDP, budgets, and so on, compared with the other South Asian countries. So the Chinese position also similar to the Western position, that it is an important country in South Asia. I mean, I don't remember any Indian saying China is an important country in East Asia, or UK is an important country in Western Europe, or US is an important country in Northern America, or something like that. It doesn't do justice to the profile of the countries involved and the kind of influence they have across. Having said that, the Chinese position in South Asia has five elements. Number one, they basically look at from the point of view of Western development campaign of investments, knocking at the Himalayan doors, railways, roadways, and so on, but basically seeing to it that China becomes a factor in South Asia. So far, it has not yet become. It has become, in terms of, for India, the largest trading partner, apart from US, but it had not become the mover and shaker in India. It had not become a mover and shaker in Sri Lanka or Bangladesh or Nepal or Pakistan. Even in Pakistan, it is not the mover and shaker, let me say this. US is still the mover and shaker in Pakistan, apart from the Pakistanis, because that is ahistorical, if you say, you know, everyone else is a mover and shaker. So the Western development campaign basically is to make China as number one in South Asian region with trade, investments, and other things. But I forgot to explain one more on the investments. I will come back again on South Asia. On investments, the Chinese investments abroad actually are very, very few and far in between. Chinese investments, they have over $3.8 trillion of foreign exchange reserves. Of course, this has to be converted into equity shares and so on, and pushed as investments abroad. That has not been done. Yet, overall, their investments are about $350 to $400 billion abroad. And all of that is in the energy sector. In Iran, over $100 billion. In Venezuela, some such. In Sudan, in Nigeria, in Angola, in Kazakhstan, the China and Indonesia, Natuna gas fields. We don't find Chinese investments in terms of industrialization abroad. We do find in some infrastructure projects, railways and so on, but we haven't seen major investments of China abroad. So this is a limitation in the... So in the case of South Asia as well, the investments by China is actually very little. are $439 million in India. That's a very, for a country with 3.8 trillion, $439 million is, I think we should not say anything about it. That's not really a high for the second largest economy. Chinese investments in Sri Lanka also are in millions. Of course, for the Hambantota project, they have invested $1.2 billion. And they have, I've seen some plans where they want to invest some $52 billion in Sri Lanka. But that's part of the Indian Ocean, as you said, string of pearls. Although I don't agree with the string of pearls, but the investments are into the Indian Ocean littoral states and other states. In Pakistan, they plan to invest, but due to Taliban rise, they are not able to. For example, King Ho Company wanted to invest in Balochistan, but Balochistan is an up in flames with the Baluchi insurgency. So there is only Gwadar port, which is, even that is not in circulation. They are building infrastructure, but not much is happening on that Gwadar front. They now have, as part of the Western Development Campaign, they now have these railway projects, road projects, Karakoram highway expansion project. But again, this is subjected to insurgency in Pakistan and the radical, movement, radical Islam in Nepal, the investments are also very few. In Myanmar, there were investments before in the energy pipeline and others, but these are now being subjected to popular scrutiny. Most of the Chinese investments abroad are not transparent, by the way. The Beijing consensus doesn't include transparency. So what exactly did they conclude with the Darfur regime is not clear. There is no MOU in black and white to say, we give you this, and this is the contract, this is the investment. So these are not transparent. The deals are not transparent. So there is a problem in fathoming the kind of investments and the output. So that is another kind of limitation in South Asia. The second major objective is nuclear balance. If India becomes nuclear, Pakistan should also become nuclear. China assisted Pakistan in the 5,000 ring magnets in the Kahuta projects in as the CIA and Shirley Khan for the US Congressional Research Report indicated, also including hexafluoride gas and other assistance. From 1977 onwards, that's happening according to the Western reports on the China-Pakistan WMD cooperation. So nuclear balance suggests if India becomes nuclear, Pakistan also should get assistance. And this is also reflected in the IAEA NSG deliberations. When we had the 1-2-3 agreement signed between US and India, there was also the Chinese proposal that Pakistan should also be given the same exemption as the Indians were given the exemption. But you're comparing oranges and apples here. Pakistan, as AQ Khan suggested, has a track record of WMD proliferation. In his February 2004 interview, AQ Khan said they have proliferated to Libya, they have proliferated to Syria, and so on and so forth, with Chinese designs, by the way. So as Monterey Institute suggested, China had a Walmart, nuclear Walmart, for anyone, everyone who can get the nuclear. So the second aspect is nuclear balance. As part of the 1-2-3 between US and India, China also is supporting Pakistan in the Chashma 3 and 4 projects as part of this balancing between India and Pakistan. The third element is the Indian Ocean region, which is where the string of pearls come up. On the string of pearls, my assessment is, and I've done some work on this, my assessment is this is not the string of pearls, but this is coming in a dual-use fashion as of now. Gwadar is not a military outpost, but could become military outposts, and we have to see whether there are these aircraft carriers, nuclear submarines placed in the Goa. So one has to really watch the place too. As of now, we don't find anything military, and so the string of pearls argument by Julie McDonald is not correct as of now. As of 2014, that thesis doesn't hold ground. Hambantota, we haven't seen any military. In fact, the first contingent to Hambantota was Maruti Suzuki cars. Some 2,000 to 3,000 cars arrived soon after the Chinese built. So the Chinese built Hambantota, Indians use it for shipping the automobiles to that area. So it hasn't become a string of pearls as of now. I mean, we have to see whether there is a military use of that port, and so we can then formulate it as a string of pearls. Yet we do find there is the Chinese interest in the Indian Ocean, because they are importing 280 million tons of oil from the Indian Ocean, 80% passing through the Straits of Malacca. So there is a genuine concern on the part of China. It is a national interest for the Chinese, because if the oil disruptions take place in the Indian Ocean, China rise will be blocked. So there is a natural, obvious Chinese interest in the Indian Ocean, which is genuine. But that has to be worked out through cooperative measures with the regional states, regional navies, regional powers, along with Devo Varche, which is the major power center in Indian Ocean region. So the string of pearls is also a problematic. But there is definitely an Indian Ocean interest by the Chinese side, and reflected in the Maritime Silk Road idea proposed to the Indian side this January. On the other South Asian, maybe we can talk later on.
Did you want to
say
something? Professor Bala, and then Professor.
Yeah. I have two very short questions, and I suppose we can look for very short answers to this. One is to Professor Tsering. You know, it's a bit ironical that China wants to stop Tibetan refugees coming into Nepal when it's actually putting in place a road through Tibet to Nepal, which will open that system completely. How is it going to stop Tibetans from passing over that road to Nepal in future? You know, how is it going to monitor that? What's going to happen on that one? And to Srikanth, do you think the RCEP actually means that the whole the East Asian economic regionalism process is now going to be China-driven rather than ASEAN-driven? I think there's a change that's happening there somewhere. Maybe you can tell us something about it.
On the roads, the Chinese expectation is that once these roads are built and developed, they would be able to, you know, put soldiers or immigration officials there and manage the entry and exit of Tibetans or Nepalese. So it would be easier to manage. Without these, because we are talking about the high Himalayas, most Tibetans escape, you know, surreptitiously. You know, they hide, you know, during daytime and escape during night. Through forests, they hire, you know, guides or human traffickers, whatever you want to call it, and they would lead you through, you know, routes that, you know, the Chinese border patrol or immigration officials and all. So it's, the expectation is that it will be easier to manage the exit, the flow of Tibetans, and then it is also to some extent the Nepalese lobbying, because the Nepalese wanted to develop their border regions as well as have more access to Tibet or China to counterbalance India's economic influence. So, you know, the Nepalese have been lobbying the Chinese to extend the Gormolhasa railway line, the highest railway, you know, all the way to Kathmandu.
or Lumbini as well, and build all these roads for their own purposes, the Nepalese. But the Chinese also see an interest in developing these to control and manage the Tibetans.
The quick answer for the RCEP is a work in progress. The ASEAN itself is divided on that front. Malaysia wants to join the TPP, is a strong contender for the TPP process, Trans-Pacific Partnership. Indeed, the Chinese have suggested initially to ASEAN plus three, now ASEAN plus one. So there is a grand design of, but ASEAN being what it is, with neutrality and equidistant from the other, I think they will resist the Chinese influence there.
After listening to a speaker's presentation, actually I got a lot of questions, but due to the limited times, I just want to say something which may involve your presentation. There are so many questions. Number one, I think in this morning, I stressed that there is no Tibet issue between China and India. Why? Two reasons. Number one, the India government officially, formally accepted that the Tibet is part of China. Number two, India government promised that they will not allow the Tibet people to organize some demonstration or any other things which is against China. So just to these two points, I think there's no, because you can find when the two when the leaders from the two countries have some summit committee or some important meetings, they never discussed about so-called Tibet issue. No. Second is that in Nepal, I think the China enjoyed a very good relationship with Nepalese government. And also Nepalese government also promised, just like I just mentioned in India case, the same thing. So I don't think China provide the economic assistance to Nepal's with political intention. Everyone knows that China is a developing country. We also need a lot of money to invest in our own countries. But anyway, a lot of Western countries request China take some international responsibilities. Yes, we do that. We provide some economic assistance to developing countries, a lot of developing countries. I just read in maybe this early morning, maybe from 2010 to 2012, China provided more than 100 billion, maybe more than 10 billion US dollars to developing countries. Generally, I think international community accepted that when China provided the economic assistance to developing countries with no political intentions. And the other things I think I should, Professor, you just mentioned the string of pearls. Actually, this names was created by the American think tank, maybe in 2004 or 2005, I forgot the date. At that time, I was working at the Pakistan. I visited the Gwadar port several times. When I came back from Pakistan, and I participated in several international conferences, some scholars from Western countries or from India request this kind of questions, but they have no chance to visit this harbor. But I saw this harbor just under construction. It's a civil harbor. There's no Chinese naval base there. There's no Chinese soldiers there. Because I was there several times. I also mentioned to the American scholar in those conference. Because United States has many spy satellites fly over Indian Ocean. They find nothing in Gwadar port. It's very clear. So there's no, I believe there's no stream of pearls. Even in that those conference, some scholars from Bangladesh, because at that time Chinese also helped the to construct maybe Chittagong ports. They said they welcome China to invest that kind of harbor. Because without this kind of assistance, this harbor cannot look like today. It's a quite a big, quite a developed harbor. Just good things. So okay, now we change it with this one. Let's go together to construct the maritime Silk Road. Okay? Why not? We changed this okay. And so, other things.
Can you make it just short, please?
Oh, okay, last question. Just last point. I think the Chinese goods, I mean the export products, why so many countries welcome that? Why China will become the 128th big trade partner? The one of the reasons. The Chinese products are, the quality is quite good, and the price is reasonable. So you would like to buy. Otherwise, you cannot explain why so many countries would like to buy the Chinese food. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Can I just take the last couple of questions? Both of you. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah. Go ahead.
Me?
No. Don't be too polite.
I have two short ones for Terry, if that's okay. First, I wondered if you could just share perhaps your thoughts on the future of the Nepalese Tibetan community as you see it, and by extension also the diaspora in India, especially as there's been a huge and dramatic drop off in the number of Tibetans actually making it to Nepal, and what consequence that might have for the diaspora. And the second question is, where is Tibetan collective agency in all of this, particularly in the light of the rising politics of martyrdom and the self-immolations that have been occurring over the last few years?
Thanks.
Geographically, Tibet is the source for many rivers of Asia. In some future, when fresh water will be less frequent or will become scarce, do you think that will make the Chinese power over East Asia and India itself more complicated?
Short question, but not short answer, I guess. Tsering, do you want to go first? We'll have a kind of wrap up from both of you, please.
Yes. First of all, that's why we invited Professor Du Yaogang. Your contribution is very highly appreciate it. I must clarify that we tried to invite two Chinese scholars, and one scholar, Professor Shen Diling from the same university as yours, had to withdraw because of family reasons. And then another scholar accepted my invitation too late, but then it was too expensive in terms of the flight ticket and everything. So we did try our best to get two Chinese scholars and two Indian scholars. Well, first of all, I agree with you when you say that India had accepted Chinese sovereignty over Tibet. As I pointed out in my presentation, in 1954, they signed an agreement. The Indian expectation is that there would be a quid pro quo on the border dispute, but that didn't come about. And then I also agree that India officially states that they do not allow political activities against China by the Tibetans. But as I pointed out, the reality is that it may be different. And the fact of the matter is that there are 150,000 Tibetan refugees in Nepal, in India, and 20,000 in Nepal, who are considered very, very separatist, or considered as separatists, terrorists, or, so considered quite dangerous elements by the Chinese government. And then we also have a border dispute between India and China, also, which is, as I pointed out in one of my papers published in China Report from New Delhi, is highly related to the Tibet issue. You could in fact see correlation between tensions on the border dispute and the tensions on the Chinese-Tibetan issue. Because of these the issues that I raised in the presentation, despite acceptance of sovereignty and the prohibition on political activities, there are other realities that make the Tibet issue central between China and India. That makes the resolution of the Tibet issue actually crucial for the resolution of other outstanding issues between India and China. And then very quickly, do you have time?
We've got about 30 seconds each.
Yeah. Future of Tibetans in Nepal and India. It is a critical sort of issue among for the Tibetans because there is a drop-off of Tibetans escaping because of the security crackdown in Nepal and by the Chinese, as I pointed out, the dramatic drop. And then there are Tibetans, immigrating to Western countries. So the diaspora community in South Asia is depleted to some extent. But what I didn't mention is that all along the northern border, Nepalese, Chinese or Tibetan border, there are ethnic Tibetan communities, like the Sherpas, the Tamangs, the Yomos. They're all ethnic Tibetans, culturally Tibetan, Tibetan Buddhists speaking Tibetan language, dressing Tibetan. So they are sources of human resource. Many of the monasteries in India are actually attended by these kind of Tibetans. So there are also the Bhutanese who are culturally Tibetan Buddhists, speak a dialect of Tibetan. And then also all along the northern Indian territories, they're all either ethnic Tibetans or ethnically mixed Tibetans, but culturally Tibetan. So they are also sources of human resource as well as support for the Tibetans. So there are the sort of two trends working both against and for the Tibetans. And then with Tibetan rivers, it is a major concern for the Indians or the lower riparian countries, Bangladesh, Pakistan also to some extent, and also Southeast Asia, where many of Tibet's rivers flow. It is a major issue. There are actually books written about wars over water in the future. So China's control over the water, Tibetan rivers, not just the rivers, but also the glaciers. Tibet is called the third pole, holding the, you know, huge quantities of, you know, fresh water, which supply the waters. So it is not just an issue for the lower riparian countries, but also a general climate change and environmental issue for the rest of Asia.
Thank you.
The string of pearls still has some relevance, although I said, because why is it that the Pakistan Defense Ministry invited Chinese to do the contract job on the Khodar port? And why not a civilian agency, number one? Number two, why is it the Khodar port expanded from 11 meters deep to 14 meters deep? Those who have some military background or would say 14 meters deep is for nuclear submarines, for aircraft carriers. These are for military purposes. Of course, there is no nuclear submarine right now, but as I said, in future we see them, then it is a military. So the options are open, the assessments will be open-ended. But as I said, Julie McDonald's report for the Booz Allen Hamilton company is, as of now, doesn't hold ground because we don't see military assets placed in these places. I also want to quickly come on the Tibet portion. If I were to be a Tibetan, I would welcome all the Tibetans to come and settle in India. Why? Because today the Tibetans have they're ranking number one or number two or number three in all India high school performance indicators. Delhi Public School is number one, and number two is refugee camps, where Tibetan refugee camps, where children are becoming, at the all India level, they are competing. Any country which you know, doesn't want talent will be doomed in 21st century. We are into knowledge economy, right? Any country which doesn't want these talented people will have problems in building up talent. So I think India will welcome all the Tibetans to come and settle down in India. We don't have any problem with them. If we have accommodated 2 million Pakistanis, 1 million Afghans, 2 million Bangladeshis, 2 million Nepalese, 50,000 Tamils from Sri Lanka, we can accommodate 2 more million from Tibet. That's not a big problem. You have a huge land, so they're very talented, and especially in IT related, they're entering into in substantial ways, the Tibetan refugees living in India. So it's an asset for India, not a problem. On water issues, indeed, that's a major problem area, because 28% of Tibetan waters go into rest of Asia, and 25% into China. So it is the area for contention, which is already hotting up. And indeed, one of the bilateral issue between India and China is the water issue. One of the contentious bilateral issue is the water issue, which has been raised in the BRICS last year by Manmohan Singh to Xi Jinping, and is further being raised at various levels. So it will become a major issue in bilateral relations. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I would now like to invite you all for a coffee break for half an hour, but before we do, to thank our speakers for a very interesting.